Your first instinct is usually right. Is that correct? Do you listen to your instincts? What are your instincts saying right now? What it is? Is it an elevator? Is it a stair? Is it telling you that you have a choice? And you have choices all the time. Some of you might think that's a trick, and I don't like it. But let's look to the forward. How about this? It's not only about our choices, it's all about choices of designers. So they might think, their instincts say, this is a beautiful design. But you see that people and their instincts lead them around this design. So this is what we have today. How about looking into the future and imagining ourselves and listening to our instincts? Do we want this? Or we would rather look back to what we have today? So all of this makes more and more questions to myself. And evolutionary, certainly instincts help us to survive and reproduce. But nowadays, when we have these all fundamental changes, what are the role of the instincts? And here, I'm standing with all of these questions, and imagine this man is myself. What it is all about? And at the MIT Media Lab, I'm thinking about these questions. How can I help people to overcome huge changes we are facing every day? And you know, change, what it is it difficult? Is it hard? Maybe. If you would ask yourself, do you want a better life? Do you want a change? You would say yes. And if somebody would ask to you, do you want to change yourself? That's a different question. So, have you ever had in your life at least one New Year's resolution saying, from the January 1st, I will gonna do this new thing? How many of you, please raise your hands. And now, how many of you have had the same New Year's resolution for several years? And how many of you have achieved a change in yourself that you have made to yourself in January 1st? How many of you? I did this year, and I'm still quite successful with it. Now, just to illustrate, this is the target group that I'm working, and I'm trying to help people of January 1st to be successful. That's my work. But we also need to know that there are people who, if they want to change, like I saw some of them are here in the audience, are successfully doing that, and that's the green circle. So if I want to change, I do it. And there is red circle. We also need to acknowledge that there are people who will never do that, and maybe you know some of your friends or your relatives, and you said to them many times the same thing, and they say, okay, I'm fine. So for the yellow circle, people who want to change but not always succeeding, we need to look for reasons why the change is not happening. And social cognitive theory says there are two areas where the barriers can reside. One is in the attitude, so the attitude might change after January 1st, or into the environment, so there is not enough ability to do that new thing. So we need to change either the environment around us or the attitude to enable these people to succeed by getting into this new behavior. And if you look at the different ways, what can be done? People can be motivated. Maybe you know these two guys. Carrots, those are incentives. Stick is a punishment. Do they work? Yes, they do. For how long? For as long as they are present. For as long as somebody gives you a carrot or stays next to you with a stick, right? So it's a limitation. There is another way what can be used to motivate people. It's through argument. So for example, here, this one runs on money and might make you fat, and the other one runs on fat and might save you money. So if you ask yourself or somebody, they would say, yes, that most likely is true. But does it work? Do people in the end try to switch over to bikes? And there's a third. There can be different kind of campaigns. And maybe some of you remember this campaign. That's Riga. And people on the bikes with a bamboo structure around them try to exemplify how much space takes up one person riding in a private car. Very nice campaign, good social media coverage, but at the same time, not many people remember it anymore. So if all of these ways to help people achieving a behavioral change have limitations, the question is there anything else around us that can serve as a helpful source of motivation for people to achieving their changes? Oh, wait a minute. Did you just do like this? You did it because I looked up? And if you did, this is a question, what it is, and why it was so powerful. If I looked up, you looked up. It's called social influence. So how people react to other people. That's a so powerful source of motivating everyone that you are able to see other people doing the same thing that you want to do. And let me give you an example from, let's say you want to do more exercising in the morning, or you want to ride a bike to work. What's important is a weather forecast. You look at the weather forecast and you have two options in this case, two cities, Stanford and Eindhoven. Better weather and not that good one. In a case, if in Eindhoven you are hesitating to take your bike because weather is not that good, what if the same mobile application tells you how many other people right now are riding their bikes to work or to school at the same very moment on your street or in your neighborhood? And although you see in Stanford is 74, in Eindhoven is 11. 11 is maybe a smaller number than 74, but if 11 are there, so you question yourself, what's wrong with me if the 11 can do it, right? And you know, when we do design mobile applications on devices like this, there are million and million applications that try to help you achieving your behavioral change. There is still one huge limitation. Who is in control? A user. If I don't want to, I put it in a pocket or I just throw it away, and that's about it. That's why my work is focused on this. It's a publicly available instant information about what's happening. So on this street, there's a bike lane and a cars, and this screen is telling you that in the last hour, the speed of the cars were 9 miles per hour, bikes 12 miles per hour. And the only way you can make as an individual a difference to what you see is your choice, which mobility mode you take next time. And there is no one behind writing an agenda. Is just making transparent of what's happening. And based on this idea, we also ran a large study in Boston and Cambridge area, Massachusetts, United States. We engaged companies like Google, like MIT, like Boston Children's Hospital, into reporting how their employees commute from home to work, and specifically looked at those people commuting by bikes. Based on that metric, we arranged them in rankings, and what we did ask, we asked them to put it in a big, large displays in their organizations. So people who never rode a bike and never aware of other their colleagues riding bikes finally saw their company, well, there are colleagues that are riding bikes. Oh, we are number two in the rank. How can I help my company to become number one? And there is a clear, simple answer. Take your bike. Then we can look at our habits towards healthy eating. And if you look at the grocery store, where products can be scanned at the counter already, based on the screen that has the red and green, products that scanned, they can have healthy or unhealthy attachment to it. And then, in the end, everyone's grocery basket can be divided into healthy, unhealthy food, and this color can represent that, and it can be put also outside of the grocery store. So if today, most of the people have purchased mostly healthy stuff, you can see that grocery store from outside as green, or vice versa as red. So you can ride your bike and you can see red grocery store, and green one, which tells you nothing more, just the fact how people have purchased their food in that grocery store. Another thing is some people say we are sitting too long. And if we have a chair that can tell us that we are sitting too long, and it turns the color from green to red, red means we are sitting already more than half an hour, for example. And it's not only that we see it ourselves, but also other people see that too. And this is how we prototype these kind of innovations. So it's a simple chair. She's my student from my class. She put a pressure sensor on the chair and an LED strip light that currently is changing the color from green to red. So it's all programmed, it's all prototyped, and now it's demonstrated how it works. So when the strip is red, she stands up and does exercising, stretching, and a lot of fun, and then waits while the strip goes back to green, which is an indicator it's safe to sit down. So you can imagine your own workplace having the same chairs, and somebody comes to you and says, it's time to stand up. And then if you think beyond just indoors, so outdoor new innovations like this tricycle, it's a new way of transportation in the city, and you can pedal on it or use electric assist. And certainly, if we ask ourselves which contributes more to our well-being, most likely pedaling, if we can do that. So, and this would instantly tell you how do you perform comparing to your own previous behavior, comparing to your behavior with the behavior of other previous riders on this vehicle, or to the neighborhood where you are riding. And now, even looking more forward, I would like to show you a structure which has been built more than 100 years ago, located in one of the beautiful capitals of Europe, that was built for a different purpose 100 years ago, that nowadays can be used as a large communication channel that can provide information about how people behave in a certain way for their own behavior. A structure that has been built 100 years ago today can tell you that number right there, large one, it can represent how many people have achieved their New Year's resolutions globally, for example. It can tell you how many kilometers people ran over the last year, for example. So different kind of things can be exhibited at a larger scale to a larger population. And when once we have that kind of innovations placed in the urban space, and looking back to the audience that we are trying to help, these are people of January 1st that who want to change already, that what we are doing, we are actually exposing the green circle, which already have changed, which already run in the morning, ride their bikes and so forth, to the yellow ones. And what happens? They gradually change the yellow ones into green and also red ones into yellow. And now you would ask yourself, okay, this is all future, it's all gonna be. Can I do something today? And let me give you an example. So I have had two of my private experiences with eating because I need to exercise to keep my weight. And when I have some trouble, I need to look back to what I eat. And you know, one simple trick for you that you can start doing today, you anchor your desire or your New Year's resolution to a behavior you do multiple times a day. Just like this one. What I did, every time I washed my hands, I reminded myself, my New Year's resolution is to eat more healthier. And it worked for me, and I believe it can work for you. Thank you.